Travelers, and welcome to another episode of Tales of Teyvat, a Genshin lore podcast. Last week, we talked about the worst character in the entire game, Dodorai, the second Fatui Harbinger. We still don't know who to trust as we round each corner in the game, and we're just crossing our fingers it isn't him. This week, we'll be discussing the one and only Aritaki Ito and the Arataki gang. Additionally, I want to remind travelers to visit talesoftevat.com to see visual representations of the lore mentioned during today's podcast. Your guides have put them together for you to make things a little easier to understand. On our site, you can also find some awesome goodies, including artist spotlights from the community for each episode, wallpapers for download, and a way to check out some of our favorite Genshin merch. Finally, feel free to email us at talesoftevatpod@gmail.com to let us know what you think of this week's episode and what topics you'd like to see in the future. So now we have the one, the Oni, Aritaki Ito! The crowd goes wild.
Can we talk about how many names this motherfucker has?
Is he beating Alice?
I think he beats Dallas.
Oh shit.
Aritaki, a vision returned, above all, bold-blooded, beetle gladiator, burning passion for battle. He might lose, but he'll never admit defeato. Long live and prosper. No prison food for me. Number one gourmet, numero uno idioso, numero uno, the first, the man, the one and only, the Oni Sumo King, the pride of Oni, the strongest, the supreme, the ultimate TCG champion.
That's not true.
Troublemaker, the undefeated, the victory goes, the spoils, Bull Chucker Ito.
Oh my God.
How many of these were made by him?
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11.
The majority.
Most of them. Except most of Chucker. Them are made up by him. But for Uno Idioso. And Bull Chucker, thank you, Paimon.
Yeah, I love those.
That kid, he's taller than Yelan.
I feel like Yelan would call everybody kid.
Kujosara just calls him Crimson Oni. His alias, though, is Aritaki Shimito.
Oh my God. I wonder who that could be.
I wonder. Oh my God. The greatest himbo in this game.
Yeah.
Hoyoverse does really good with himbos, as we've seen in Star Rail recently with Sampo. The motherfucker, I want to peg.
Wait. Star Rail needs to come out with their own brand of shampoo and conditioner now.
Exactly. Is it heads and shoulders or is it just shoulders and head?
Oh my God.
Oh no.
Did you get that, Brandon?
I heard it and I approve of it. Yes.
Look, I ship any gay ship with him.
Anyone with Ito?
No.
Sampo.
Oh, Sampo.
Shit with shampoo.
Also Ito. For me, there's a couple of really good ships with Ito, which we'll get to. But he's got many names, and I think a lot of this is just off the cuff spitting by Max Middleman, the greatest he is.
Yeah.
Am I allowed to tell a quick Max Middleman story?
Yes, because we're about to shout him out. I'm going to talk directly to you, Max, because if you're not listening, how fucking dare you?
Max, if you're not listening to this podcast, what are you doing?
What are you doing?
He's sitting there, like, listening to the podcast, crying. He's like, oh my God.
He's, like, counting his cash.
So, we have a friend, Mason, and when I first started getting into, like, listening to voice actors and figuring out who they were, he was like, just look up Max Middleman. He's everywhere. And I was like, what? And then I did, and I looked him up, and he's quite literally everywhere. Like, he's Ito, he's Plague and Miraculous, he's One Punch Man. I was like, what? So then I met Max at a Comic-Con, and I told him that he's everywhere, and that my friend told me about him because he was everywhere. And he looked at me for a half second, he goes, honestly, it's the truth. I don't know why I'm everywhere, but I am. Like, oh my God.
Getting that money.
Such a humble, like, not himbo person.
Don't make my dreams be dreams. Don't take away that. I want to imagine him as the himbo man he voices.
I mean, that is definitely inside him.
In somewhere.
It's just an aspect of him. He channels that.
Buried deep inside every Max Middleman is a himbo just dying to get out.
Yeah. But I think it kind of comes, like, Ito is one of those characters where people either love him or absolutely hate him. And I think it's like, you know, it's that attitude, and it's, I think it's just the way that he is portrayed too. It's fantastic. He ends up being a very polarizing character because of that.
It's hard with Ito because, you know, his heart is like always in the right place.
Yes.
He just doesn't know how to like actually do stuff with his heart being in that place.
Yeah.
I generally like him, but I gotta say, I hate the hombre, like the Spanish stuff. Really.
Didn't you make a drink based around that word?
Yes.
What?
Yes, you did.
You made a drink based around the word hombre for our drink. Yes.
El hombre. I didn't hear what you said. Oh. Yes, I did.
Oh my god.
But I don't like it. Because it's like every time he talks, he says something.
Too much hombre. Not enough fucking dude.
I find it confusing too. I mean, maybe it'll make more sense if we get to like Notlan and we discover that they're sort of like Spanish named stuff. You know what I mean? Like,
would love that. I hope so. I want Notlan to be the largest place.
They incorporate Chinese and Liwei and Japanese and Inazuma, but like, where's the Spanish coming from?
Especially because he's supposed to be like, he's in Japanese Inazuma, right? But he's also like a rock star. Like his whole persona is like drummer in a rock band. So like,
so would you guys like to learn something about a very niche group of Japanese culture?
Sure.
Yeah.
That is obsessed
with Ito?
No. With Spanish, and specifically Los Angeles and like Southern California Hispanic culture.
Mm.
Like imagine cars that can lift and bounce.
This sounds like a French film that B made me watch once.
Oh my god, oh my god. Trauma.
Wait, is that the one that I'm thinking of that we all were in and we were all kind of like disgusted but can't turn away?
The car fucking.
Yeah.
Oh, and not! I wasn't thinking of the car fucking. I'm thinking of the other French one where the guy just comes out with his giant schlong and it's an orgy.
Oh, I was MIA for that movie.
We didn't watch that one together.
Oh, that
that was your other Discord group.
It was anyway, but it's a very small portion of, I wouldn't say small portion. It's a group. It's kind of like a clique of people who are really into Hispanic culture. And so we're looking at like Dia de los Muertos as becoming very popular, like tattoos of the Mother Mary and all this stuff is becoming very popular within this like niche group who's kind of taking on, or I wouldn't say appropriating, but they are appreciating in a very specific way of Hispanic culture because of movies and shows that they might have watched. So that is what I'm thinking this relation is. Probably not at all purposeful.
I just think he's a bro.
Absolutely.
It just fits.
Yeah.
He's a him bro.
Don't you think that Max Middleman, like during recording, was threw it in there and then they like were like, let's go with that.
I hope so.
It'd be very interesting to know that. Like, are there any like ad libs that happen? Like, you know how they happen within different movies and stuff like that, but how common would it be like in a game like this, especially one that has multiple translations? And, you know, we see how many times we find mistakes in the subtitles to begin with. So like, are they set in stone beforehand or after? It would be very interesting to know.
Yeah, I think about that too. Every time that Max Middleman speaks through Ito, because it feels so improv'd.
It does.
All the time. I'm like, that was not in the script.
He just might be that good.
Well, I would imagine like the bigger voice actors too. I mean, they have quite a few like more well-known voice act in the game, and Max is, as far as I know, in the top 5 or 10 most well-known voice actors in the game, right?
Yeah.
Yes, I would. Yeah,
they might give people like him really their own free reign, but like, you know, when Marco Meatball was in the Lantern Right, they were like, script, Marco, script. Like,
seriously, they were that strict on the script for him?
Not that he said it, I'm just saying, like, I can imagine, like,
oh yeah, probably.
Someone who's not like a big voice actor, because like Max clearly could get very much in the character. I mean, have you ever seen the Lava show that he does with Robbie Daymond and Ray Chase?
No.
So it's like a live show that they do sometimes at cons, and I got to see it at Anime NYC this year, and they are so good at improv. They are amazing at it. So I wouldn't be surprised if they let people like them. I mean, Robbie Daymon is the voice of Tuxedo Mask in Sailor Moon.
Oh, fucking. Okay. Now I get it. I'm like, why does that sound familiar? That explains a lot.
But anyway, Max Mittleman, we love you. If you listen to the pod, we love you.
He's very talented.
Yes, please sing us happy birthday coming this August.
Yes.
The Tales of the Bot pod.
So Ito is an Oni, which is like the first time we ever hear the word Oni in the game is Ito. It's kind of the only time we ever hear Oni in the game is when we're talking about Ito.
Well, it makes sense because the Oni have kind of become scarce. Okay, so we've talked about this previously, but yokai in Japanese folklore, kind of like they're mythical creatures, cryptids, all this sorts of stuff. Some people refer to them as demons if you watch a lot of Inuyasha.
Woo!
But Oni are kind of considered more of the evil ogre or troll-esque yokai. They are representations of like murder and cannibalism, but are also linked to good fortune and wealth because the way to get rid of them, which we'll talk about beans. Give me the beans! And they are always like different skin colors, like yellow, red, blue, black. Very vibrant, always linked with thunder and lightning, which most prevalently seen in Inuyasha, of course. There's twin brothers who are both thunder and lightning, and they're supposed to be Oni brothers. They're horned, and sometimes they have three eyes, but they usually live in seclusion, and there's not many of them. And sometimes they wear masks. Really cool fucking masks. And it just reminds me of Dead by Daylight when you're running from the Oni or Onion if you're some of my friends who played Dead by Daylight, running away from this giant creature who's got a Kanobo club, which is just a war club with spikes on it.
Like Steve Harrington's like that?
Yes and no. Not so much nails, but more like, you know, back in the scene days when you had the belts that had those studs?
Oh, yeah.
Basically that all over a club.
Like from Hot Topic?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Shout out to Hot Topic.
Hi, Hot Topic. I was one of those kids that wore about like five of those with different colors and all neon. Welcome to the early 2000s. But basically, they took the imagery of the Oni in Japanese folklore and implemented it into Genshin and put it into Ito, into this dumb himbo. And it takes on such a different aspect because, one, he isn't evil. He's not, you know, a representation of murder in cannibalism, because in folklore, in a lot of literature back in the day, they're represented by like eating people, so like full-on evil Shrek. But
I'm shook that cannibalism keeps being brought up in this game.
I'm sorry,
every week
it has to be first donor right now, Ito. I'm sorry, but they took that and gave it kind of a happier and more fun-loving spin, and that's basically Ito. He's got the look of an Oni. He's very strong. He's not secluded.
No, but that kind of comes into the story though later too, with the two types of Onis that we have in Genshin, and the type that he isn't secluded. They're very much amongst the people.
Exactly.
They love the people.
They love them.
I wonder what that's like.
But like you were saying though, Fiends, an Oni is a type of yokai which are from Inazuma, and you can kind of, to bring it back to our previous episodes too, you can look at a yokai as the type of like an illuminated beast that we had in Liyue, which the illuminated beast was the yakshas and the bird people. Forgot their name.
The bird people.
Cujos?
No,
like Cloud Retainer.
I like cloud people. Is it what Paimon calls like her? Isn't it like bird lady? For you.
Oh my god, it's a bird lady. Wait, which is Bee's husband? Is that Mountain Shaper or Mountain Carver?
There's one that he hates and one that he loves.
I know, that's why I'm like, I can't remember.
We don't ever see him, so.
Yes, we do.
Listen, I'm in a long distance relationship and he changes his handle sometimes.
Oh my god. His handle? I'd be sus of that.
His antlers.
Yeah,
like, oh my god.
But yeah, so he's a yokai as well.
But like I said, there's two different types of Onis in our game, the Crimson Oni and the Blue Oni, which always sounds like the Crimson got like a cool name and Blue was just like
Blue.
Well, they couldn't say Azul because then they're really throwing the Spanish in there.
Yeah, they could have been like Cyan.
Turquoise.
I mean, it kind of makes turquoise sense with their personalities.
True, that is very true. Very good point, Brandon.
They could have said the Sky Oni. Because then you could bring in thunder and lightning.
I like
croissant. But actually, you bring up a good point, and they are kind of not two. Well, I guess they would be two bloodlines.
Yeah, they are. They're two different like tribes.
And Ito is considered a direct descendant of the Crimson Oni. And originally, when the Oni started to, like, you know, get with humans and, you know, get down.
More breeding.
Yes. All the breeding. Yes.
Oh, no.
The brightness and the vibrancy of the crimson, like, skin color, or the very deep blues of the blue Onis weren't passing down to their half-human offspring. So now, within the bloodline, those who are descended from the crimson and the blue Oni will use markings. I don't think it's tattoos. I'm just going to assume they just paint themselves.
I believe it's that they paint it. They paint them on.
Which is really cool. And I'm fascinated with that fact. Because, one, you could have tattooed it. Because we've seen tattoos in this game. We know Ningguang has a very, very delicious tattoo on her thigh. Just thirsting over Geomami. But it's almost in a way of like a ritualistic war painting, but not. It's denoting of what tribe you're part of, what family you're part of, what bloodline you're a part of, which is so cool because you see Ito and his eyes, they're bright red. So of course, why wouldn't people just see it and denote that? His horns are red. It's like the act of putting on these markings shows like there's a really good, there's pride in being part of one of these tribes, which historically, from what they say in the Genshin lore, that the Oni have been a very prideful and very like principled people, which we see in Ito a lot. He's very principled.
Yeah.
Which seems very strange when you look at his behavior.
Yeah, I know. He seems so like, woo, like wild and carefree and like would ride a motorcycle with no cares, wind in the hair, no helmet on.
But he's also a criminal.
Well,
yeah, he's true. A delinquent.
A delinquent. He's a troublemaker. Is he a criminal?
Yes.
I mean,
well, he's been arrested
but
many times.
Mm-hmm. Yes, but
it's Kuki's only job is to kind of keep them out of trouble.
She is a great defense attorney.
I mean, she's the real leader of the Arataki gang, right?
She truly is.
Yeah, but it wouldn't be the Arataki gang without Ito, would it? Because it's just Ito and his friends.
Let's take a step back for a second. And we just read a lot of terms. So for our travelers who might not know or might be a little confused, Ito, who goes by Arataki Ito, also has his own like gang. And they're not very gang-like in the game. Nah. We kind of see them like post-criminal activity. But again, remember, like Ito's got like heart, man. So he's doing things that are getting him arrested, but they're like, it's a good place. It's like his heart's in the good place. Yeah.
It's like disturbing the peace is all he's really getting arrested for. Like he's maybe jumping on rooftops, stealing candy from children.
I mean, gambling that's pretty
with
bad.
Children.
Lots
to
of things
steal their candy. Like, a lot of it is just delinquent bullshit behavior.
But within the Arataki gang, there is a member named Kuki Shinobu. And Kuki has some pretty interesting lore all in herself. She's the only other person in the gang who is a playable character. She's a 4-star. She came out not really that long ago. She came out during the Fantastic Compass event.
Right before, I think.
Yeah, right before.
All I know is that Tiff heals really good in co-op.
Yeah. Yo, she does so good.
Oh my god.
I love calling her Kuki, but her name is Shinobu. And yeah. I keep getting that wrong because her name is Kuki Shinobu. And because they're Japanese names, her name is Shinobu. I guess we can say we call her by her last name, like you would say, like, you know,
Beans.
I don't know. Beans. Beans.
Like me.
Yeah. Cause like even like she has a sister who's an NPC in the game. And her name is Kuki as well, but not Kuki Shinobu.
I'm like, they thought she was going to be a shrine maiden, but they really named her for what she was going to be, a Shinobu.
I really enjoy Kuki as a character.
Yeah. I do too.
I think she came out with the chasm because we need the chasm serpent, right? To upgrade her?
Yeah.
Yes. So she must have come because she, I know she came out before Haizo did.
Also, most importantly, isn't that your favorite butt in the game, Tiff?
It is.
Nah. Kuki, I love Kuki's butt. She has the perfect little tight little tushy. But Rosaria's butt is my favorite because that's juicy.
She's a runner up.
Mm-hmm.
A rumper.
I just think Kuki has the cutest little hiney.
Not the rumper. No.
Rumper. Like a rump. Anyway.
She's got a cute hiney.
She's in your top three.
What's your top three?
She's definitely in the, she's second. Kuki's definitely second.
Who's number three?
Yeah, who's Shenhe?
Shenhe.
Just give us like the whole list.
Yeah, Shenhe's got that fucking dump truck.
We did a poll a while back on our like Instagram and Twitter of like who everyone's favorite butts were, and people kept saying Kaya.
That was a joke.
That man scratched off his ass.
Those were joke submissions.
I don't know. Like three or four of them, man. I was like, I miss
it. Josh in your chain, man. Josh in your chain.
Wasn't that right after Kaya's whole meme went around showing that picture of his flat ass?
Oh, maybe. So. You know who has a good butt though now? Kaveh. Did you see that video they released of him where they like zoomed up his thigh? I was like, wow, they really wanted to say this man has a good ass.
I mean, he's got
it. You've been asking for it. Here's a good butt.
You want a man with an ass? Here you go.
He rejected all of his money and he's still, you know.
That's all the squats he has to do.
Oh my God, so many squats.
But yes. Back to Kuki. So Kuki is a member of the gang as well, but she is also a lawyer that studied in Liwei, like, and is good friends with Yanfei?
Yeah, she was born into a family of basically of shrine maidens, and at a very young age, they made her join and be a shrine maiden, which is just rude.
It is.
And she decided that she didn't want to do that, so she doesn't really talk to her parents anymore. They weren't all that happy, much like most of us know. When we pick a different career path, our parents might not be all that happy about it. And she basically went around like doing a whole bunch of different things. And then she studied in Liwei, and that became like the thing she really enjoyed the most, was actually being in law and kind of keeping the order. But it works out with that she's a part of the gang because she gets to also have that fun kind of side where she's not like, you know, like Yanfei, who's a little bit more by the book. And like I said, she does have a sister. You can go see her sister. Her name is Kuki Mayuki. She is a shrine maiden NPC at the Grand Namakumi Shrine. And a little fun fact, Kuki avoids going there. So I find it very rude when I bring Kuki there all the time.
You know, so many people avoid that shrine for different reasons, though. Goru's like, yeah, Miko, keep me away.
Yeah. The Guji, forget that.
Yeah. Speaking of Goru, not to sidetrack away from Kuki, but isn't Ito obsessed with Miss Hina?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. The point that, like, he actually got a question answered. Here's the thing. I think he was so impressed and so shocked that he had to put it down because it says that the gang found out, showed it to him. And he looked at it and set it to the side.
Well, you know, it's so funny you say that out because that story actually is about how he got his vision. So,
oh yeah, because it came out. It came out of his butt because it literally he woke up and he was sitting on it.
Yes.
Oh.
So Ito woke up one day and he was like laying on a vision. He was like, "Oh, sweet," but he had no idea what to do with it. Like he was like very like, "This is a magical piece of equipment, and I am not ready for it."
He's like, "Should I put it back up?" Up there?
Yes.
So he actually bought like a really nice like little pouch for it. And it's presumed that he wrote in to Miss Hina and was like, "Miss Hina, like, I don't know what to do with my vision," basically, and asked how to take care of it and like how to clean it.
Oh my God.
Well, he wanted it to be the shiniest vision ever. He wanted it to be shinier than everyone else's.
And Miss Hina was like, "Go to the pharmacy, get something called a douche." This is how you clean your vision.
But yeah, so he was like super impressed basically by Miss Hina's results. And travelers, we did just talk in quite extensively about Miss Hina in our Yai Publishing House episode, but Miss Hina is Goru basically. It's a Goru writes like for a self-help column almost and answers people's questions. So Ito was like super excited. But while we're on the topic of his vision, he also lost his vision to Kujo-Sera during the Vision Hunt Decree, right?
Either his real vision or a fake one, because we do know that there were some fake visions being handed out, because he did eventually get his back. So we don't actually know if it was stolen off of the omnipresent god or if he just had used a counterfeit that he was holding on. But yeah, he lost a battle to Kujo-Sera and she took his vision because that's what she was doing in the Tenryo Commission. But he's still so salty about it that he, every time he sees her, he like challenges her to a sumo wrestling match. Mm-hmm. And he's very upset that she has not taken it.
Can you imagine Kujo-Sera's like sumo wrestling? Like, oh, what? Yeah. Oh, I like how you guys are like, yes, I can. Yeah. I'm like, oh, all right.
Like feathers going everywhere.
Yeah. She's that shoe, the 1-point shoe.
Something that Ito loves to do is basically make battles and duels with people. He actually won a bet with Yaimiko, and he refers to her just as like the fox lady, but they were going to this like food stand and Yaimiko was sitting in his chair. And he was like, hey, fox lady, that's my chair. Get out. And he challenged her to a ramen eating contest. And she was like, sure, but we're going to make it a kutsune ramen eating contest. And I think it just changed like the type of ramen it was. But Ito won and he got his chair. And they said the vendor was like so scared. Like, it was like, what is happening? He also enjoys beetle battles.
Mm-hmm. The Amikaboto?
Anikabuto?
Anikabuto. I just call them the beetles.
You have purple beetles and you have brown beetles.
You have John beetles. You have Ringo beetle.
Thank you, Brandon. That's where I was going to. Or the
juicy berry beetles.
Well, maybe we can actually just go back a little bit further. Because we kind of skipped over Ito.
Yeah, who's and that?
He kind of started from.
Who?
Yeah, like, we went right into it.
I don't know Ito.
Arataki Ito. He is a Crimson Oni, like we said. He's from Inazuma, from an area called Hanamizaka. His parents have died because the orphans. It's
R.I.P.
But yeah, so his parents died when he was young, and he was actually homeless and would just kind of like wander around and stuff. This was at a time too where there was a lot of like people were almost like racist, I guess, against Onis. And in his little town, there was a time when there was a lot of like robberies and they all of a sudden just assumed that it was the Onis. So he was used to people being shitty to him. So as he was homeless and wandering the streets, this old human lady was like, hey, you need something, kid? And kind of took care of him. And from that day forward, he lived with her and called her Granny Oni. She is not an Oni at all. She raised him because she just felt bad that this little kid was like homeless and stuff.
And it was so sweet because she really chose the hard life of compassion, where like she agreed to take care of him and raise him, but then that was at the cost of society like treating her like crap as well.
Yeah, so as he grew up then, you know, with Granny Oni, and she still is very much in his life, he started his Arataki gang. They apparently have a lot of disputes, and I'm not sure if any of you know what those disputes are of when this gang was started. I know that there's disputes. I don't recall exactly like who thinks it started when I think two of them think it started when they grilled lavender melons. And then one of them, I forgot actually what Ito thinks it started as, but Kuki.
Ito says it started when he thought of it. He says the second it came into his mind, that's when it started. Which I'm like, okay.
To Kuki, it didn't start until he was arrested, or like the gang was arrested and they're like actually officially on some kind of booking. Because even though they call themselves a gang or an organization, even in that sense, the Tenryo Commission refuses to acknowledge that.
Well, yeah, it's just him and his friends just doing stupid shit.
But as much as they try, so that's probably even runs more into his whole thing with Sara. But yeah, they refuse to acknowledge them as a real group.
Poor Ito. They're like, we're the Arataki Ito gang. They're like, all right, kids, move on.
Yeah.
It kind of makes me think of the moles in Star Rail. Like, Hook is in charge of like this like little group of kids.
Oh my God.
I'm sorry. Hook.
He's one of my daughters.
Hook is adorable.
Yeah, you actually love Hook, Tiffany. Like, even I do.
They
should
put her in Genshin. She should be in Genshin.
She's awesome. In Genshin. Her name is Klee.
Not wrong.
Voice actor name is Mona.
Yeah, it's Mona. It's Mona's voice actor, right?
Really?
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Oh. I love her more.
Tiff's like, maybe I should just like play Starbrail until
No, maybe I shouldn't. Maybe then she'll get all I need to do is just watch you guys.
You're like, actually, Mona has fucked over my 50-50 way too many times.
I love her, but yeah, she has fucked me quite a bit.
I wish she would fuck over my 50-50 a little bit more.
That's how I feel about Tignari. So I get it. Brandon has all the Tignaris that I want, and I have all the Monas that he wants.
Yep.
But since you mentioned Granny Oni too, and when we do Ito's storyline, that's really when we first get to meet Granny Oni. And she's out on Tatarasuna with a little boy named Daisuke that Ito, I don't remember if we help Ito rescue him or if Ito had already saved him, but we find out that his parents have been like kidnapped by like a, I don't know what to call him. Like it's one of those giant like samurai guys and his gang.
Oh, that's right on the tip of my tongue. So I always have to look for the belt buckles. The guys who give you belt buckle, that, that's belt not good enough. The belt buckle guys.
The belt buckle boys.
They're samurai.
Yes.
Is it Nobushi or Kairagi?
Yes. Yeah. And he's like working with the last of the blue Oni, Takuya. And he's like kidnapping kids and parents off of Tatarasuna, like just people in general, I guess. And Ito brings Daisuke, the one little kid, back to Granny Oni to take care of and do beetle battle with. And he calls him, does he call him like Brother Ito or something like that? Like, or Big Bro?
Yeah, I think it's Big Bro. Because, like, I mean, he's been through trauma.
Which is funny because he's so bro-y.
During all of Ito's story, too, we get to find out the Oni story,
mm-hmm.
which is a beautiful cutscene that we see in two parts.
Oh, it's so cute.
And it explains the Onis to us. And it's a story about a Crimson Oni and a Blue Oni whose names are Aka and Ao. So the Crimson Oni looked very fierce, looked very scary and stuff, but was very gentle with, really liked the humans. Like he was gentle like them. The Blue Oni, on the other hand, looked a little bit more human, but was very reclusive and didn't want to have anything to do with any of the humans.
Mood.
But because the Crimson Oni really wanted to be friends with these people, the Blue Oni, like a good friend, came up with this little scheme, that this little plan where he would go to the village and start trouble, and the Crimson Oni can then come in and stop it, and then all the humans would be like, yay, Crimson Oni! And it works.
Because humans were, like, afraid of all Oni at this point, right? Like
they Yeah, I don't think they were very kind on any kind. Like, the Blue Oni just happened to look a little bit more human, so they weren't. I don't think the Blue Oni were as scary at that time.
They were passing.
Yeah. So after all this happens, the Crimson Oni goes back home to like tell his friend, like, hey, it worked. I have all these friends. And he's gone. The Blue Oni leaves him a note that says like, hey, I'm glad this worked. I'm out. I'm just going to travel. Don't bother looking for me, kind of a thing.
Like, how fucked up is that?
But says like, we'll always be friends, but see you never.
Like, the fuck, man?
It was so sad because the really Blue Oni was like, oh, look at the Red Oni. He's, you know, so happy. I don't belong here because I'm a creep.
Yeah. And
yeah, it was sort of like a, I don't belong here. So they just sort of thought they, the Red Oni would be better off without them.
Yeah.
Is how I took it.
It's so sad. But the Crimson Oni loved his friend and did actually look for him. But they kind of found that the Blue Oni was actually like hiding from him on purpose. Like he kind of like figured it out, like he was in the same area. So he left a letter, just like his friend did, and said like, hey, I'm going to have this big ass party with all my bros. Come hang out. You know, even if you just hide in the distance, I still want you to come to this party.
Mm-hmm.
And the Blue Oni does show up and he's watching from a distance to see this little party, and he thinks he's hiding, and the Crimson Oni like jumps out and he's like, hey, come meet my friends, and all this stuff.
Yeah,
so the story kind of goes from this point on, like, that those two types of Onis were watching this kind of take place with this other story, where we see that the Blue Onis are still very reclusive, and to the fact that most people think that they're gone because they just don't come out that much, but it kind of turns out they're like in bad shape and not doing too hot. And that's kind of where the story goes along, and Ito, as a prideful Oni, is like I gotta take care of you people, like that's just, we're a part of this pact, like we have to do this, which is kind of leans toward why he's such an awesome little character.
Mm-hmm. I'm going to throw a fun little wrench in the Oni story, though. So, you know how in the latest, like, Nahida arc online, we find out that Nahida has been, like, putting stories into, like, children's kids' books so that when Irminsul gets changed, she still has, like, these breadcrumbs to go back to.
Is it called Everybody Poops?
Because it should be.
No, it's called Everybody Dookies.
Everybody Duke Dukes.
And the story of the Anxiety Duke. And we also were talking during our Yai Publishing House episode that we felt Yai Miko might be trying to do like an archive type of thing in case Irminsul gets changed as well, since some of her books are telling true stories but are kind of sold as fiction. Wouldn't it be interesting if the Oni story is one of those? Maybe it actually represents something else that happened in Inazuma. Potentially, I don't know, maybe like the divide between Inazuma and Watasumi Island originally.
Ooh.
Or something else too. I don't, that one came to mind just because we talked about Inkonomiya recently, and we have that TCG event going on where you see Kokomi play, and she's kind of like, for years we've been annexed, like we haven't been Inazuma, and it would be interesting if that's kind of like relating back to them somehow. I don't know. But I would be very curious if the story of the Oni is something more. And maybe Onis weren't really a race and Ito's just a yokai. And so is Takuya, the blue Oni that we see in game.
So it's just like a representation of the yokai in general?
Maybe. I don't know. Like, maybe they're just yokai. They're not necessarily like a specific race of yokai, you know? Kind of like how there's Kitsune, but there's also like these random yokai that we meet during the like Test of Courage event.
Mm-hmm.
We meet like all those kids and stuff and learn a lot about the yokai overall. I don't know. That's just my like little random thought of the day.
I like it. I like mm-hmm. it.
Can we also say, though, to go back to the storyline where we first meet Granny Oni and we learn about Takuya, the blue Oni, who's like doing bad things. Like, Takuya's gonna get arrested. Like, he's doing some bad shit and Ito tries to stop him.
Mm-hmm.
And it leads to one of the best cutscenes in the game.
Oh my god. Like, he did something so fucked. So fucked. And something, I don't know. It got us to this cutscene. I kind of forgive it for that, but I also don't.
Wait, what's the cutscene?
This is the cutscene where Ito goes back to save Takuya?
Yes, yes, yes!
Oh, yeah.
We'll link to it on our website for travelers that haven't seen it, of course. But basically, we enter a domain and we're kind of sneaking around the domain as we do. And we find the bad guys who involves Takuya, the blue Oni ancestor. And everything around us starts to fall apart. I forget exactly why. I'm pretty sure it's our fault. And Takuya basically decides that he's going to sacrifice his life.
Yeah, they do like a lot of trope building to set that up where we think that, oh, well, he's the villain. He's going to sacrifice himself. So we don't actually think anything else of it. And then when Ito saves him, it's like a shock.
Mm-hmm. And it was beautiful and scary. Like, I was really worried about Ito for a hot sec.
You were like, oh my God, he's going to die.
Oh, I was like, we had just lost Tepe. I was like, I can't go through this again.
Oh shit. Oh,
Tepe.
Poor Tepe.
And then we lost Rue.
Insert the chorus, the angelic chorus.
The Greek chorus is coming in. No, I mean, it definitely seems more along the lines like Ito absolutely would not leave a bro, even if that bro absolutely fucked up.
I mean, he's the one usually fucking up, so he's used to it. He's like, I wouldn't want to be left behind, so why exactly. would I leave you behind?
He also probably thought, like, people don't do these things, you know, for no reason. Like, he's obviously been led down a wrong path for multiple reasons. And maybe he thinks, I can fix this man. I can fix him.
Well, we find out from Takuya that the blue Oni, you know, from the fairy tale left civilization and sort of created their own hangout cut off from regular civilization. So the whole like blue Oni clan sort of grew up and developed apart from everyone else. But then, you know, they were destitute and started having to steal. So it's really like a reflection of the original Blue Oni's anti-social vibe, where they're, you know, set apart from everyone. But what I really loved at the end is when Takuya is getting arrested, Ito is like, he vows to take care of his family. And I thought that was so sweet.
It is so sweet. I would like to know what Ito has done, though, to take care of the family. I got a lot of questions about that.
He's stealing stuff. He's probably gone to jail several times doing something for them.
He's probably been arrested and then, like, convinces Toma to accidentally poison him. And it's like, you gotta let me go. It wasn't my fault.
Beans. Beans everywhere.
Beans and beans and beans. Beans.
That's, like, one of my favorite parts of the Iridori Festival.
Is the beans?
Yeah. Oh my God. I was cracking up. So for our travelers who might not know, Ito is allergic to beans. He says he's like, isn't he like one of the only Onis he knows who's allergic to bees? Beans?
So here's the thing, and this is also a part of like Japanese folklore, but there's a particular festival. So Setsuban is a festival basically where people will use beans as a way to purify someone's home. So like kind of like the evil energy goes into the beans.
I hate it.
And they will also ward off spirits. So having beans like on your windowsill or something will ward off, you know, Oni and bring good fortune and wealth. And so the closer you are, or the more directly descended of the Crimson or Blue Oni you are, the more severe the allergy is, which goes to say that Ito has a severe enough allergy that'll knock him on his ass quite quickly.
Does he really have an allergy?
Yes.
That's my question.
Like, legitimately, yes.
I swear, like, Toma gave him, like, a chickpea or some shit.
Well, he did, and he passed out.
Mm-hmm.
He didn't do it on purpose.
I'm making this stuff up. I have made Toma a bad guy, because in my mind, I'm like, he knew he was allergic, and he was like, nah, I don't think so.
Toma's, like, the nicest guy in this entire game.
That's my husband, excuse me.
He would test the waters, Brandon.
No, that's just Ayato you're thinking of.
Oh, yeah.
Poisoning Toma. So during the Iridori Festival, this is the first, like, big festival that Inazuma's had since they've reopened their ports and are allowing people back in. Toma is all excited, and he gives Ito, or he's there when Ito gets like the signature drink of the event,
mm-hmm.
and he's poisoned. And Toma's like, what is happening? Oh my God. Like, he's like, we need to get help. And they're like, he's allergic to beans. Like, all of his gang members are screaming.
It's fucking beans.
See, I have totally every single time been like, ah, he's faking it.
I mean, he could be. We don't
Maybe
know.
Maybe I'm just mean.
Allergy. Some people actually have allergies.
I know. I have stupid ones. I'm allergic to cantaloupe. You'd think I would actually believe the man. It's the stupidest allergy to ever have.
Why? Why is it so stupid, Tim?
No one ever eats it. That's why. It's like, you wouldn't think of it.
I love cantaloupe and honeydew so much, and it was the saddest day of my life when I had an allergic reaction to it. But like, I had to get epidural shots in my back for a back problem, and they put wristbands on you, like, allergic to penicillin, and then they added one, allergic to cantaloupe. And I was like, where in the surgical center are you going to just randomly hand me cantaloupe?
Cafeteria.
We needed this on my wrist. And they always look at me, they're like, cantaloupe? I'm like, I feel like I need to tell you. I just feel like I have to tell, like, a medical professional when they ask me if I have allergies. But, you know, it's dumb, because they're just like, you know, cantaloupe just randomly show up.
You never know. It could be in a med or something, or like a flavoring. Like, you don't know.
I had a friend on a plane actually reach across the aisle and knock a fruit cup out of my hand once, because I just was like, oh, cup. And she's like, you ass.
No fruit cup for you.
Well, I think maybe you're faking your cantaloupe allergy. Like, Ito's faking his meat allergy. You're really allergic to penicillin, Tim? I don't know. Yeah. Let's test it out.
Yeah.
No, poor Toma.
On the section of the podcast of Let's Learn About Tiff.
More Tiff!
More Tiff!
There will be a quiz.
Just the Tiff.
You better ace it.
I'm dead.
Speaking of Toma, though, isn't Toma Ito like a ship?
Oh, is it?
Well, it's Toma Ito Ayato is a thruple.
It's the thruple that's the ship.
Oh.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah. They had that whole moment during the, was it the Iridori Festival?
Mm-hmm. It's hot. It's legit.
Mm. It's not my favorite Ito ship.
No.
It's absolutely not. Either.
Yeah.
My favorite ship is Toma B. Sorry.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank
but
you.
But Ito related ships.
You know I don't like the main one. I really.
I know.
But you don't like Goru. That's why.
I don't like Goru. Yeah.
I love the Ito Goro ship. I love it.
I don't like it. I'm like a one bit.
I can understand a little bit.
What do you like?
You know, there are times when I go, okay, the Ito Sara, like enemies to lovers kind of trope, you know, like that would work. But, you know, I actually said it not that long ago who I thought Ito would be good with. And now I've totally forgot.
Oh, really?
I remember you mentioned this.
Apparently, I didn't believe myself too much because I don't remember it.
Is it Kuki?
No, you want to say Kuki. You want to say like it would be Kuki, but I really don't think
so. Like she's got to be taking care of him for a reason.
Right? Yeah, but I think my girl Kuki is like an ace. She's just, yeah, she's not.
Yai Miko.
Yaelon.
Yoi Mia.
Yes, it was Yoi Mia.
Yes, Yoi Mia. Thank you.
Yes. Oh my God.
But it's a good one now that you know it, right?
Yes.
You don't see that one, like, a lot out there.
They're both very positive. I've seen a lot of Ito Ganyu, and it's just from one specific artist, and I fucking love it.
And they technically live near each other, too, so it's like, you know.
I don't know. I ship Yoi Mia with Kazuha for the most part, although, man... Am I interested in Hu Tao Kazuha after the
Junior event? I don't like it. They were definitely pushing it.
Yeah.
Definitely pushing it. I was like...
Hu Tao stalking around in the background?
Mm-hmm.
I was more into Kazuha Kuching.
No!
Yeah. Like, she needs someone to mellow her out. And yeah. She needs order.
That's Ganyu. I'm pro Ganyu Kuching.
Ganyu Kuching?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, I can see it.
That's a big one. I never thought about that one, but that makes sense. Yeah,
I'm good. I like that one.
I'm content. Although, this is
I approve of this ship.
This is a ship that would, like, never happen, but imagine the chaos. Yoi Mia, Hu Tao.
Oh, my God.
Oh, my God, the chaos.
Yes.
And then they just start hanging out with Klee a little bit more.
Oh, yeah.
No.
They're like babysitting Klee.
They're making bombs with Klee. That's the code for that.
The Albedo and Kaya are like dropping her off like, oh, God.
I mean, Yoi Mia Klee is like one of the sweetest relationships in the whole game.
Yeah, but then you add in the chaos of Hu Tao, who will just bring out the chaos of both.
Yeah, she would be like, Yoi Mia would be like managing the both of them.
Hu Tao would probably try and like have a funeral for Dodoko.
She would like be snatching Dodoko off of her backpack.
Yeah.
We're going to bury him.
Hu Tao realizes that Yoi Mia has an older parent and is like, you know, I could offer you a discounted rate if you book with me right now.
Also, Klee, your mom is on a lot of dangerous adventures.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Don't you think you should get like a life insurance policy with me?
Oh, she's such a creep.
I love it.
Yeah, it's fantastic.
Oh my God. But I don't know who my favorite Ito ship is. I fall right in the middle with Goru and with Sarah. Like, I'm cool with both.
Yeah, it's hard to choose because I love the fact that the very Shakespearean Ito is in love with Miss Hina and is best buds with Goru. And I just like just connect the fucking dots and just fuck.
Yeah.
What is so bad? But I also love, again, the enemies to lovers romance of Kudozora and Ito. But there's also, because I mean, Ito is the bi icon. He is literally, his birthday is the first day of Pride.
Goro and Sara sort of have a lot in common. I mean, they're sort of, you know, army dudes.
Yeah, yeah, they're both army generals. They're both mm-hmm. bow users.
He likes bows.
They're both uptight.
Is it in the TCG event that we see them chatting it up? When Kokomi and Yaimiko are, when they have their little TCG duel, they have their second in commands with them.
Can I just point something out? Every person we genuinely shipped Ito with was a bow user.
Yeah, it was.
Goru, Sara, Yoimiya, and me for Ganyu?
Yeah, look at that.
Interesting.
Geo and bows go together.
Geo Claymore, a big club.
Yeah, he's got a big club.
I mean, that makes sense because it's like the personality of like a Claymore versus like an agile bow user.
Yeah.
But, you know, Al, you were just talking about how Ito's birthday is June 1st, which was recent, you know, and it's the first day of Pride Month, but I believe it's also World Children's Day.
Aww.
In certain countries, I don't remember which ones, but it's also Paimon's birthday.
The lavender melon.
Yes, the fact that Ito and Paimon, with their like angst against one another, share a birthday.
They love each other.
It's so good.
The floating lavender melon and fucking bull chucker.
Floating lavender melon, I think, is the cutest nickname.
But they both think it's like the most insulting thing that Ito could have ever said.
Yeah. Or like bull chucker. He's literally chucking a bull. Like, that's not, how can that be insulting?
Exactly.
Ushi's a bull.
He's like, Ushi is more than a bull to me. You peasant melon.
They count Ushi as a part of their gang too.
They make me laugh every time they have dialogue together. Like, so every good. Single time. It's like a guaranteed laugh.
It is one of those relationships that I get very excited with when we're gonna see.
Yeah.
You see Ito show up and you're like, ooh, what type of bullshit is Paimon gonna see today?
Typically I go, oh, Ito's here, I can't wait to see what kind of bullshit he says. And then I'm like, oh wait, Paimon's here too.
You know, as far as I know, Paimon and Ito are the only two Genshin characters to share a birthday.
I think there's one other one. I thought there was one other one.
Oh my god, I forgot that they have the same birthday. That's perfect.
My Josh and... No! Kuki and Klee share a birthday. July 27th.
Oh.
Kuki and Klee have the same birthday.
Oh. Isn't that interesting that it's another Arataki Ito member? Like, gang member?
And a chaos person.
Oh my god, yeah.
Chaos.
Oh, I can't wait to celebrate Klee's birthday. Oh my god, so we celebrate Klee's birthday every year at the archipelago? That's so fun!
At the archipelago?
No!
Archipelago. Where's Auntie Alice in our fucking plane tickets?
I don't know. I don't think Alice likes us.
She's too busy murdering her husband.
I said she got big old bitties. Is she upset that I sexualized her in a way that she probably didn't want to be sexualized? She got big old bitties.
I do want to, though, say that Ito loves kids. I think that we've kind of hinted at that the entire time when we're like, Ito gambles with the kids. Ito beetles battles with beetle
battles. Yes, Oni Kabuto battles. Yeah, all the time. And it comes with his childlike demeanor. And I think a lot of it stems with he, as a child, was kind of alone in the world until he had a Granny Oni. And he kind of is this somewhat protector of fun for the kids of Inazuma City, and that he's always there to make sure that they're having fun, and he always respects them in a way that a lot of adults don't, because Ito is shown every time he's having a fight, every time he's having like a game, he takes everything seriously, regardless of who he's like actually fighting against. It could be this three-year-old, or it could be the Raiden Shogun. He's going to give it his all. And he treats them, you know, like equals. And I think for kids in a small society where it's like, they're fucking kids, who gives a shit? And like, they're just off playing on their own. Like, we don't see parents interacting with kids. We see them talking about their kids or overlooking them as they're talking about the dandelion seed, Bonstadt, little mushroom boy.
Yeah, I think also, like, Ito doesn't care about getting beat by a kid, where most adults are like, ugh, I just lost a child. He's just like, all right, I lost a kid.
He's like, damn it, that kid was tough.
Only he's like, I will win next time.
Exactly. Yeah.
I made him very chill about losing, and that is not Ito.
I mean, it's never like chill, but If you think as a kid, if you were playing against an adult and they were like, I just let you win. Or if like, oh my God, next time I won't lose. Like, which would you prefer?
Yeah, he's very earnest in his battle with children.
Mm-hmm. It seems so weird. And like, it's one of the reasons why like a lot of the dolls or the people of Inazuma are just like, ugh, it's Ito. Like, he just does kid things and he's unemployed. Like, all this shit.
Unemployed? I'm dead.
He's 3/4 unemployed.
The way he explains it.
His job is to do what Cookie says.
Yes. And then maybe spend some time in jail. But he definitely has in the way of like, I want to compare him to Peter Pan, even though Venti is a better comparison to Peter Pan, but he definitely embodies that forever boyhood, a band of mischievous boys who are wreaking havoc, because he's got his band of other mischievous boys and Cookie.
His quote unquote gang.
His gang. Because they're all his friends. Like, he's just hanging out with his buds.
That's what Granny Oni says. Like, she doesn't actually look at them as a gang. That's just Ito and his buddies.
It's the truth of it, though. Because, and he really cares about every single one. He knows all of their problems. He understands, you know, what makes them tick and what they like, what they don't like. It's not that, oh, these are just like my henchmen. He really cares about people.
Yeah, they're his chosen family.
Exactly. Yeah. And a lot of it, you know, because he's chosen, like, Granny Oni chose him, so he's choosing more and more parts of his family because he was abandoned. He was left alone in the world.
Like so many characters in this game.
Yes.
Like so many children.
But he was abandoned by death. It's a little different. He was orphaned by unforeseen circumstances. Not like Klee, whose mother just left her.
Do we know how his parents died?
It just says an illness.
Elazar.
Ooh.
Mm. Could be the illness from Tarasuna.
Yeah, the poison.
Mm-hmm. I think it really will just depend, but either way, like, I mean, he probably saw himself in like all the orphan children of Teyvat, because there's, oh my God, too fucking many. We need several more orphanages.
No, I don't think we should gather the children up and put them anywhere, because then Dottore is like, hey, thanks for making that easier for me.
That's true. I mean, but they're already being swiped up in the other one.
Yeah, they are. And well, in Mondstadt. Just keep the orphans out of Mondstadt.
Yeah. I mean, no one's taking Timmy.
Seriously, why has nobody taken Timmy? That motherfucker.
You know why?
I mean, really, like, could you please?
No one wants him.
I mean, I think he's a prime subject for Dottore.
He's already evil.
He's so annoying that even the Fatui don't want him. They're like, no, hard pass.
You go up to those two Fatui mumbling in Mondstadt together, and they're like, that kid is the worst. Yeah,
so hard.
Don't let the knave take him.
What do you mean the knave? The knave doesn't even want him. Zaritza doesn't even want him. And it turns out he's, you know, the second one who came.
Timmy is Piero. I don't know what you guys are talking about. You know how like Skara's number is like empty right now in the Fatui Harbingers? That's Timmy. And I like Timmy.
I think he's one of Dottore's segments.
No!
He's the youngest.
Timmy's dad didn't die in a hunting accident. Timmy murdered him.
Mm-hmm. I would believe that in a second.
Yeah.
Giraffe was too drunk.
Mm-hmm. Threatened him with his little, like, pigeon fork. Like, meh. Don't you tell anybody.
Maybe that's why Giraffe drinks. He saw Timmy just, like, with his birds.
His dad shot a pigeon and Timmy snapped.
So he snapped his neck just like he did those pigeons.
Have you guys ever seen Shrek 2?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Constantly.
No.
How many times? I don't know.
Okay, we'll send the clip to you, Brandon, to watch afterwards. There's this scene in Shrek 2 where, like, all the princesses are going into battle to Barracuda, and they're like, ah! Like, to the song, and, like, Snow White summons all the birds. That's Timmy.
Do you want to know a weird fact about that scene? The opening is actually not part of Barracuda. That's part of Zeppelin's Immigrant Song.
Is there anything else y'all would like to mention about Ito and his gang or Cookie or anyone?
That he's got a giant bulge?
Ito does?
Oh.
Does he really have a bulge? Has he passed the check?
He has passed the check. It's quite With our new method, not the one that we do in Leeway, the other method.
The Mondstadt one?
Mm-hmm.
Oh.
Wait, what's that method?
You climb onto Wagner's sign.
Yeah, because Wagner has the biggest bulge of all.
Oh, right, right. I know this one. Yeah.
Wagner has to decide.
Wagner says, if you shall pass.
I mean, Wagner's annoying. I like the blacksmith and Leeway.
Both hot.
Also, like, his dad approves of our relationship, so.
Wagner's a jerk. That doesn't take away from the fact that he's hot or whatever, but he is a jerk. He's very mean to us.
He can disrespectfully hammer me anytime.
Wow.
Look. We're talking about a bi icon. I gotta live my bi life.
Well, travelers, I do think that's all the time that we have for today. Thank you so much for coming down and listening about Ito and his gang and all the crazy mischief that they get into and some other stuff as well. We really had a big episode. If you like this episode and you want to tell us what you think, or you didn't like the episode, you want to let us know what you think, you can let us know on Instagram, Tales of Tevat Pod, or you can let us know on Twitter, Tales of Tevat. You can also feel free to send us an email, talesoftevatpod@gmail.com. Next week, we are going to be discussing the gods of the desert. So buckle in. It is going to be a very wild ride. There is a lot to dive into. Otherwise, travelers, safe journeys. We'll see you next time.
Bye, cantaloupe nerds.